Welcome to today's program with Terezin Da Silva of the Anne Frank House joining us from Holland. I'm Ari Goldstein with the Office of the President at the Museum of Jewish Heritage, a living memorial to the Holocaust. I first met Terezin in May 2019 when she flew to New York along with a colleague from the Anne Frank House to personally deliver artifacts to the exhibition Auschwitz, Not Long Ago, Not Far Away. Several of the original objects she brought had once belonged to Anne and Margot Frank, and it was the first time they had ever been on display in the United States. So it was a very exciting moment for us and for our visitors as we got a little closer to Anne Frank's extraordinary story. Today, 2 weeks after what would have been Anne Frank's 91st birthday, we'll explore her story a little further as we learn from Terezin, who is a true expert in Anne's life and legacy. Terezin Da Silva was born in Lisbon, but she's lived in Holland and worked at the Anne Frank House for more than 36 years across multiple departments, producing exhibitions, writing books, running communications, and leading collections management and research initiatives. In her current role as head of collections and part of the management team, Terezin is responsible for overseeing a very rich collection of artifacts, which includes Anne's diary. Before Terezin begins her presentation, I want to offer a brief reminder that the Museum of Jewish Heritage hosts free public programs every week, and these are only made possible thanks to the support of viewers and community members like you. So please, if you can, take a moment to visit the museum's website and make a contribution or become a member to support our work as New York's Holocaust Memorial Museum. Lastly, as Terezin is speaking, please feel free to share comments and questions in the Zoom chat, and we'll do our best to address as many as we can in the Q&A portion at the end of the program, which we hope we'll leave about 20 minutes for. Without further ado, thank you everyone for joining and welcome Terezin.
Thank you very much. I will present to you a PowerPoint about Anne's life, legacy and diary. But first, I would like to thank the Museum of Jewish Heritage for inviting me today to give a presentation about Anne Frank. And to you, my audience for today, I cannot see you, but I know you are there and I thank you for being there. Today is a special day because it's exactly 73 years ago that the Diary of Anne Frank was published for the first time in the Dutch language, in the original language that Anne Frank wrote it. It was published for the first time on 25th of June 1947, only 2 years after the liberation. The English version, the American version, was published for the first time in 1952. The next page, please. I work at the Anne Frank House in Amsterdam, and our strategic goals are the following. We want to carefully manage the secret annex. That's the place where Anne Frank was hiding and where she wrote her diary. We want to share the life story of Anne Frank with as many people as possible, with the aid of an historically reliable, authentic and appealing presentation of her life story. We want to prevent and fight anti-Semitic notions and actions, and we want to make our target group aware of ways of thinking and acting that will lead to racism and discrimination, and to encourage young people to make an active contribution to the promotion and maintenance of an open, pluriform and democratic society. Today, we can see society changing and experiencing how the polarization between different social groups is increasing and that democratic values and freedoms are under threat. More than ever, the Anne Frank House aims to bring young people closer together and propagate their positive values. We want young people to realize that it's in their own interest to make a contribution to a society in which people with different backgrounds and beliefs can form a close community. The next, please. The Anne Frank House is a museum with a story. The building in the middle is the original building which Otto Frank rented in December 1940, where he had two kind of businesses. And in the museum, we offer more background information about Anne Frank and the time in which she lived. And to walk through the original building at the Prinsengracht 263 in Amsterdam, through the front house where the helpers of the Heiders were working, and to the annex where the 8 Heiders lived for 25 months, is above all an emotional experience. Things were changing very rapidly, and Otto decided in 1933, when Hitler came to power, to immigrate or to flee to Holland, to Amsterdam. It was not the first time that he was living for a while in Holland, because he lived there in 1923, when he set up a Dutch firm of the family bank, the Michael Frank Bank. But this bank, with the financial crisis in the 1920s in Europe, went bankrupt, and he went back to Holland, to Germany. And then for him, Holland was a country which he knew. He had already a lot of friends over there. So that's why they decided to immigrate with the children and with his wife to Holland in 1933. He set up a new business. It was called Opecta, and Opecta was a specimen to make jam in 10 minutes. And what you see on the picture is the business on the Prinsengracht, the building itself, and his colleagues with whom he worked. And later, some of them were the helpers during the hiding periods. In 1936, no, this is 1938. Maybe you know the Frank family were part of the liberal Jewish religious community, both in Frankfurt and Aachen, where Edith was from, and in Amsterdam. At home, they celebrated both Jewish holidays and Christmas, which was quite exceptional. Edith Hollander, the wife of Otto, grew up in Aachen in a more religious environment than Otto. Both her father and her brother were members of the board of the synagogue congregation. They were not Orthodox, but more traditional than Otto's family. But liberal Judaism was virtually unknown in the Netherlands. And with the arrival of a large number of liberal German Jewish refugees in the Netherlands, an attempt was made to establish the first liberal Jewish community in Amsterdam. And this, despite the resistance of the Orthodox congregation, they succeeded, and in 1938 the foundation was a fact. And many supported this initiative. You see all the signatures. And if you look well on the right, you see Otto O. Frank. That means Otto Frank. So including Otto Frank. And Edith and Margot visited the synagogue every Saturday while Otto and Anne stayed at home. They were, Otto always said, my wife was progressive and had a deep religious feeling, and Margot followed my wife. And Anne and myself had less spirit to go to the synagogue. And the picture you see is the first opening ceremony in 1936 of this Jewish liberal religious community. The next, please. The Frank family hoped that they could be safe in Amsterdam. And Otto wrote to a very good friend, Nathan Strauss, in April 14, 1936. And we have to remember the name, because he will be very important later. And Otto wrote to him, because of Germany's proximity, the smell is not always pleasant, but the Dutch are tolerant. Politics in general has lost their course. Europe sits on a powder keg, no matter how the present differences will be resolved. So there were, he was very much aware of the situation in Nazi Germany and was very worried about it. And because of this, and because he didn't feel very safe anymore, he tried to set up, the next slide please, he tried to set up a new business in England, in London. And it was the same business, an Opecta business, so to have the specimen to make jam. But unfortunately, he did not succeed, and he was quite often in England in 1937, but it was not possible to set it up, the business, and he had to remain in the Netherlands. The Frank family tried to make life in the Netherlands as pleasant as possible. But after Kristallnacht, on the night of 9 and 10 November 1938, the fear grew that Netherlands would not remain neutral. Edith's two brothers were arrested in Germany, and Otto and Edith tried desperately to bring Edith's mother to Amsterdam, which they succeeded in 1939. And the two brothers were able to immigrate to the United States in 1939. So they remained in Amsterdam, and they applied to immigrate to the United States. So they tried to have, when the situation in England was not successful, they tried to flee to the United States in 1938, but that was not easy. Margot, we must not forget Margot. She was a very happy, nice, studious, serious person. And she had a very good health, and she liked to draw. And I show you this picture because before Corona, before COVID-19, we were supposed to go to the Museum of Jewish Heritage and bring new collection to the museum to take part of the exhibition they have about Auschwitz. But unfortunately, we were not allowed to travel anymore. But now I show it to you. And one of the things we were going to bring were these two pictures. We acquired them last year for the first time. We did not know that these pictures existed. And it shows you a very happy Margot with the glasses on the right. And she also sits in the boat. And one of her mates, her role mates, had a diary, and on the diary you can see the boat and the name of Margot and all the other rowing mates. Next slide, please. And another collection we wanted to bring to New York is this medal. It's an original. And on the 8th of September 1940, Margot and her three teammates won the first prize in a rowing match. And they were very, very proud of it. Her friends wrote in her diary, "We had won several years in a row. We trained often. But when we heard that Margot could not row anymore," because that was when Holland, the Netherlands was occupied and anti-Semitism was growing in the Netherlands, she couldn't row anymore. And the coach, Roos van Gelder, was not allowed to train us anymore. We were so angry that we decided unanimously to go on strike. And it's a sort of resistance that the friends of Margot showed to help Margot to endure the difficult situation. The next, please. Holland was occupied on the 10th of May 1940. And it was a surprise because during the First World War, the Netherlands was neutral. And everybody thought that Holland could keep this neutral position in Europe. But unfortunately, the Germans thought differently. And they occupied Holland, and that changed, of course, everything. And Jews were no longer allowed to own their business, which meant for Otto in 1941 that he had officially transferred both his businesses to two of his employees, Victor Kugler and Johannes Kleiman. And then he became unemployed. He had to stay at home the whole day. A very difficult situation for him and for his family, of course. Informally, he remained the owner, and the generosity of his employees was very, very high. Otto and Edith panicked in 1941 and tried to immigrate to the United States. Maybe you can show me the next slide, please. They tried to immigrate to the United States. And you see here, they ask immigration for five people: Otto, Edith, the two children, Anne and Margot, and the mother-in-law of Otto, the mother of Edith, Mrs. Hollander, Alice Hollander. With the help of prominent friends, one of them was Nathan Strauss, whom he wrote in 1936. We saw the quote a few slides earlier. And Nathan Strauss, his family was very important in the United States. His father and his uncle owned the Macy's. You know them, of course, the Macy's warehouse, a very big warehouse. They had a lot of money, a lot of influence. They knew the wife's president at that time. And Otto tried to involve him in his efforts to immigrate, to flee to the United States. He needed an affidavit, which he got. He had to borrow money for the necessary papers and the crossing. Unfortunately, in the Netherlands, there was one American consulate to deal with the immigration applications, and that was bombed on the 14th of May, 1941. And all the registrations was lost, because as you remember, he tried to immigrate to the United States already in 1938. And we don't know to which level he had gone up to, but anyway, he had to start all over again in 1940 when the consulate was bombed. In the United States, immigration was controlled by the Congress, and the law continued a system of national quotas, setting an annual limit on the number of people to immigrate to the United States. Congress did not pass a new major immigration law for refugees between 1933 and 1944. That meant that it was only a very limited amount of people who could enter the United States from Europe to the United States, which was very sad, because otherwise, no, the Frank family could have been saved. in 1942 on the 12th of June, and only a few weeks later, the Frank family had to go into hiding on the 6th of July. They were preparing themselves. Otto had already prepared the hiding place in the annex of his office at Prinsengracht 263. And they had made a plan to go into hiding on the 13th of July 1942. But Margot received on Sunday, the 5th of July, a call to report for labor in the east of Europe. And instead of going into hiding on July the 13th, they went into hiding a week earlier. And on that Sunday, she heard from her parents that they were going to hide. She didn't know anything about it, even, and Margot also didn't know anything about it. And she writes on June 9th, a few days before she heard that they were planning to hide, and she writes on June 9th, 1942, July 9th it must be, only when we were walking down the street did father and mother reveal little by little what the plan was. For months we'd been moving as much of our furniture and apparel out of the apartment as we could. It was agreed that we'd go into hiding on July 16th, I'm sorry, not 13th. Because of Margot's call-up notice, the plan had to be moved up 10 days, which meant we'd have to make to do with less orderly rooms. The next, please. So then they went into hiding in the morning on the July 6th. And here you see on the left, the front house of the building, and on the right you see the annex. The house had a front house and a back house. I will show it to you later. With whom did they went into hiding? The next, please. They went into hiding with the family van Pels. And they were father, Herman van Pels, mother, Augusta van Pels, and Peter van Pels. The next, please. The eighth person into hiding was Fritz Pfeffer. He came into the hiding place on November 7th, 1942. And Anne Frank had to share her room in this secret annex with him before she shared her room with Margot. But Margot was already 16, 17 years old, and they didn't want to let Margot sleep with Mr. Pfeffer. Anne Frank was still a young girl, and so they decided to move Margot to the room of the parents, and Anne Frank shared her room with Mr. Pfeffer. And in her diary, we can read how difficult it was, because the age difference was very big, and they quarreled a lot, and it was really very difficult for both of them. Next, please. Of course, you cannot go into hiding if you don't have help from the outside world. And Otto and Herman van Pels, who was also one of the people who worked for the business of Otto, and that's also why the van Pels family went into hiding together with Otto. They were business mates. They asked the people who worked at the office, also at the Prinsengracht, if they were prepared to help them during the hiding period. And they all said yes. There were six people in total. And the youngest one was Beb Voskuil. You see her on the right with the glasses on next to Miep Gies. And Beb was only 22 years old. And to imagine that when you are 22, suddenly you are responsible to help 8 people in hiding with the fear you have that they are going to be arrested, the fear to do shopping for them, that because for 8 to get food for 8 people, you have to be very, very careful. And for all the people, or for all the helpers, it was a very difficult time. And they became also, some of them became very nervous about the whole situation, because the situation took 25 months. They first thought that it would only take for a year. So Otto continued to pay the rent for his house. But it took much, much longer, 25 months. The next, please. Here you can see how the building looked like from the inside. You see the front house to the left and the annex on the right. And the annex part, only the 3 the 3 levels, up the 3 upper levels was the hiding period, the hiding space. And through the whole building, people worked during the day, and that's why they had to be very, very silent during the day. And at night, they used the whole building. So when you visit the house, you walk through the whole building, and then you walk through spaces where also the hiders stayed at night and in the weekends when the office was closed. Next one, please. Here you see the famous bookcase that was built in August 1942. That means that when they entered the annex in July, 6th July 1942, the bookcase was not there yet. There was only a door to cover the annex. But then on the 4th of August, and you see an advertisement or an article in the newspaper of the 4th of August 1942, and in this newspaper, it's in Dutch, so I will translate it. It says that the German police in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam, is going to search for bicycles. And they ask everyone to enter their bicycles. And the search was going to take place in the center of Amsterdam. And the hiding place was located in the center of Amsterdam. So then one of the helpers took the initiative had the idea to build a bookcase in front of the hiding place. So the father of Bert Voskuil was asked to make it. He was a carpenter and he was working in the warehouse downstairs. At that moment, didn't know about the people in hiding, but he was informed and they trusted him. He was the father of Bert Voskuil, one of the helpers, and he built the bookcase, and they never, to say the truth, they never came up to look for bicycles, but the hiders and the helpers were very pleased with the fact that the hiding place was much better covered with the bookcase now. Next, please. And Anne Frank writes about it, and she says, "Now our secret annex has truly become secret. Because so many houses are being searched for hidden bicycles, Mr. Kugler thought it would be better to have a bookcase built in front of the entrance to our hiding place. It swings out on its hinges and opens like a door. Mr. Voskuil did the carpentry work." And here you, yes. "Now, whenever we want to go downstairs, we have to duck and then jump. After the first 3 days, we were all walking around with bumps on our foreheads from banging our heads against the low doorway. Then Peter cushioned it by nailing a towel stuffed with wood shavings to the door frame." The next one, please. Well, one of the items you can already see when the Museum of Jewish at the Jewish Museum of Heritage will be open again, you see this this wooden handle. You see one of the helpers on the picture near to the bookcase, and he had to pull the wooden handle, and if he pulled the wooden handle, the next please, it's the next slide, if you pull the wooden handle, you pull up a hook, and when you pull up the hook, the door behind the bookcase will be open. So that was a very, very genius system they have made there. And in this way, the helpers could open the bookcase very easily. And you will see in the museum the original wooden handle, because this, for some or other reason, it has been remained. And we received it as an original collection from the Frank family and from the hiding period. The next slide, please. This is a reconstruction of how the annex looked like during the hiding period. We see here on the left the room of Anne Frank, on the right with all the images on the wall. The right is the room of Otto and Edith. At the bottom left is the kitchen and the living room and the bedroom of the Herman and Augusta von Pels. And on the right at the bottom, you see the very small room of Peter von Pels. And upstairs is the annex. When you visit the Anne Frank house nowadays, the rooms are empty, because the emptiness was the wish of Otto when he was very much involved by the opening of the house as a museum. And when he returned, he was the only one to survive the Holocaust. When he returned, the house was empty. Everything was gone. The furniture was gone, the people, his family, his friends with whom he hided were gone. They were all killed during the Holocaust in the concentration camps. And he wanted for him, the emptiness of that annex symbolizes the emptiness he felt when he returned from the camps in Amsterdam. And it was his wish to keep the annex empty, and nowadays it's still empty. It's very impressive to see it, if you know that it was really the wish of Otto to do so. The next, please. Maybe some of you have ever been to the museum and walked through the house. In her diary on July 11th, Anne Frank wrote, up to now, our bedroom with its blank walls was very bare. Thanks to Father, who brought my entire postcard and movie star collection here beforehand, and to a brush and a pot of glue, I was able to plaster the walls with pictures. It looks much more cheerful. And you see two pictures because she was very fond of, when she came in, she was very fond of film stars. More childish pictures. And during the hiding period, she grew up, she became older, and she developed herself. And she was not so much later on in 1943, 1944, she was not so much interested anymore in these childish pictures, but also not in film stars. And she became much more interested in history and in art. And you see these two pictures that she posted over the more childish one. She posted the pictures of art. And one is Leonardo da Vinci, and the other one is Hermes and Dionysus. The next one, please. During the hiding period, Anne and Margot and Peter van Pels, the children, they studied a lot and they read a lot of books. And when Otto returned from the camps, they took not everything away. So in the closet remained the photo albums, 4 photo albums. That's why we have so many pictures of the Frank family. But also some of the books he found back again. And he kept them and he gave them to the Anne Frank House when we opened as a museum. Another thing he got from the helpers, maybe the next slide please, is Anne's diary. And of course, everybody knew that Anne Frank wrote a diary. Not everybody knew that, and that also Margot wrote a diary. Unfortunately, the diary of Margot was not saved. Only the diary of Anne Frank was saved, because after the arrest on the 4th of August 1944, the two helpers and one of the warehouse employees went upstairs and they saw the diaries lying on the ground. They grabbed them and they took it along to the office and they kept it for Anne Frank when she returned from the concentration camp. Unfortunately, Anne Frank never returned. And when Otto Frank knew that Anne and Margot died, Mietries, one of the helpers, gave the diary to Otto. And he couldn't read it in the beginning. He was very emotional. The next slide, please. Everybody knows this red diary, the first one, but in 1942, she wrote and the diary was full. So she continued writing in her diary in other books. And you can see it here. There are more diaries of Anne Frank. And unfortunately, they did not find 1943. So whole 1943 of Anne Frank's diary is missing. We don't have it. It was not kept. It was not saved. But fortunately, Anne Frank decided on the 20th of May 1944 to rewrite her whole diary because she wanted to publish it. And she rewrote her diary on 215 loose sheets. And you see them at the bottom at the left, different colors. You see the loose sheets. And because she rewrote her diary, we also have her diary text of 1943. The next page, please. Well, as I just told you, they were not betrayed. We don't know if they were betrayed. They were arrested on the 4th of August, 1944. They were sent to Westerbork on August 8th. And after a few weeks, the last train to Auschwitz-Birkenau, there were the Frank family and all the other hiders, they were on the list. So if they were arrested only a few weeks later, there was no train going anymore from Holland to Auschwitz. They went to Auschwitz-Birkenau. All the men went to Auschwitz I. And the women remained in Birkenau. Herman von Pels died on the 3rd of October 1944. Fritz Pfeffer was sent to Neuengamme and died on December 20th, 1944. Edith Frank died on January 6th in Auschwitz. Margot and Anne were sent on the 1st of November 1944. They were sent to Bergen-Belsen. And they died there of typhus in February 1945. Auguste von Pels died on a train from Theresienstadt, from Bergen-Belsen to Theresienstadt. She died in the train on April 45. And Peter von Pels was liberated on the 5th of May in Mauthausen. But unfortunately, he was so ill and had worked so much and under such terrible circumstances that he died on the 10th, 5 days after the liberation, he died on the 10th of May, 1945 in Mauthausen, in Austria. And Otto survived. He returned to Amsterdam where he came in June 1945, and there he found out that his two children were dead. He knew when he was liberated in Auschwitz, he heard that Edith died already. But when he returned to Amsterdam, he went to the station every day with a lot of other survivors, and asked to everybody who returned if they knew Anne and Margot Frank, but unfortunately. Next slide, the last one. Well, Anne Frank became a symbol through her diary. She had her diary gave her a voice, and all the pictures gave her a face again. And on the 5th of April, 1944, Anne Frank wrote that I want to go on living even after my death. And I know what I want. I have a goal. I have opinions, a religion, and love. If only I can be myself, I will be satisfied. I know that I am a woman with inner strength and a great deal of courage. And it's the diary now that it has been translated in more than 70 languages, and is still a source of hope for a lot of people in the world. And this is the end, and I want to thank you for your attention.
Terezine, thank you so much for that amazing presentation. I'm really struck by those words at the end, by Anne's maturity at such a young age, and her foresight in thinking about who would be reading it, and about maybe what awaited her. Everyone, please feel free to chime in with questions in the chat. I've noted a few that have been submitted already. Let's start with this one. You mentioned Otto Frank lived until 1980 and died in Switzerland, and that he played a role in shaping the way that the Anne Frank House told the story. Could you go a little bit deeper into how Otto Frank lived his life after the war and what his legacy is?
Yes, of course. Well, Otto survived, and during the trip back to Amsterdam, he met some old neighbors. And when he returned in Amsterdam, he fell in love with one of his old neighbors, and he remarried in 1942. He got the diary of the helpers, and in the beginning he translated some pieces of the diary for his mother, who was living in Basel in Switzerland, but then a lot of people were very interested and told him, please, you have to publish the book. So he did in 1947, 73 years ago. And then Anne Frank became known through the in the world. A lot of the diary was translated in a lot of languages. Otto, from 1952 on, was living in Basel with his new wife, Fritschi Markovic. And they both lived with Anne Frank, because they were always remembering Anne Frank. They were always writing letters to people who were so impressed by Anne's diary. He was very much involved in all the translations of the diary in the first play that was made by the Goodrich and Hacketts in the United States, in New York. It was first shown in 1955. He was very much involved in the first film about the diary of Anne Frank in 1959. And he also was very much involved with setting up the Anne Frank House. And his goal for the house was really to help young children to continue to live in a democratic world, in a world without war, and he set up a documentation center. He organized youth conferences with young people from all over the world. He did it every year, and he traveled a lot to tell his story. His what he went through during the hiding place. He never told much about the camps. He could not. It was too terrible, his experience there. But he also wanted to look forward. He didn't want to look backwards. So his aim was to look forward and to help young people to have a good life after the war.
You mentioned when we were chatting earlier that a significant percentage, it was 50% of visitors to the Anne Frank House are under 30, which is amazing. So, and it strikes me that you're really fulfilling his wish that children be
absolutely
educated.
Absolutely, yeah.
Since you've been at the Anne Frank House for 36 years, what's changed about the house over that time and about your work?
Oh, a lot of things changed. The annex always remained the same. Nothing has changed there. But the front house has changed a lot, because when I started to work at the Anne Frank House, the front house, a part of the front house, was still an office. We only had that building. But during the years we expanded, because when we started the museum in 1960, we received 9,000 visitors. And well, in 2019, last year, we had 1.3 million visitors.
Amazing.
And when I started in 1984, the front house had changed. Offices were made in the old building. There were also exhibitions, but were from small rooms. Big rooms were made to make an exhibition space of it. And then in the 90s, we thought of bringing back the front house to the atmosphere as it looked like during the hiding period, because we wanted people who visit us that I could also see the front house as it looked like during the hiding period, because the story starts with the people who were working there and helping. We wanted to give more attention to people who were helping the hiders, so we changed that. In 1999, it was presented to our queen, and 2 years ago, we changed the front house again, because, as you just told, 50% of our visitors is younger than 30 years old. A lot of them don't have grandparents anymore who can tell about the Holocaust, who can tell about the Second World War, and to understand the meaning of the house, to understand the importance of the story of Anne Frank, we have to tell them more about the context of the Second World War, and especially the Holocaust. Otherwise, it's a story only about Anne Frank, and we want to broaden that story. Because it's important also to know that Anne Frank was only one of the 6 million Jews that were killed, and that the Holocaust was that the Holocaust took place because of National Socialism, and it happened, and we have to learn from it. And that's also what Otto Frank always said: if we don't know the past, we can't learn from the past. So that's very important.
Absolutely. We just have a few more minutes, so let me close with this question. There are a lot of questions we're not going to get to answer, and a lot of interest in learning more about Anne Frank's story. So this is a few-part question. First, would you recommend any books besides her diary for people who want to learn more? Two, what is available from the Anne Frank House while you're closed? Do you have virtual tours or resources that you would suggest? And three, what can people look forward to when they hopefully can plan visits after the pandemic is over?
Well, to say the truth, we closed our museum on March 15th, but we are open again. We opened June 1st, only for 30 people's, for 30 persons each 15 minutes, because we have to keep the distance of 1.5 meter. So we are open again.
I should adjust for American viewers who sadly can't travel to the Netherlands right now.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Maybe for Americans in the who living in Europe, but we had already a very big project, an educational project done. It's called the Video Diary. You can watch it at YouTube, and it's very, very interesting, because what we did is we asked a young girl of 13 years old to play Anne Frank. We refurnished the house, but not the real house, but another building. We refurnished it as the annex. And she films herself as Anne Frank. So it's a young girl living now in the Netherlands, but she's playing Anne Frank, and it's a sort of vlog. It's not a real vlog, but it's similar to a vlog. And it consists of 15 episodes. And we launched it after Corona. We were supposed to launch it before, but then it was Corona suddenly was there, and we thought, well, we can't launch it anymore. But then within the situation that people were locked up in the houses, could not go outside anymore, a lot of people in the world started to compare themselves with Anne Frank. They could imagine better than ever what it meant to be locked up in your house and that you can't go out. And then we thought, well, we have to launch this fantastic video diary, because there are now so many people, young people at home, they can't go to school. And if they watch this video diary, they learn much more about Anne Frank, a lot about her feelings, her fears, her hopes, everything she looked for in her life. So we launched it, and it's very successful. Already more than 1 million people have watched it. And well, please go to YouTube, www.annefrankyoutube, and watch the video diary. It's very interesting.
Thank you. And to everyone watching, we'll send a follow-up email so we could include a link to the video diary. And Terezin, if there's any other resources or books that you would suggest, we can include them in there as well. I'm sad to say that we've reached the end of the program. There's so much to cover, but truly thank you from all of us at the Museum of Jewish Heritage for joining us and sharing a little piece of your important work that you do every day in Holland with us and our audience. To all of you watching, thank you. Please check out the museum's website and feel free to tune in to any of the free public programs that we host about a lot of topics related to the history and legacy of the Holocaust.